So, as we have seen that there is explosive growth in online content. Okay, and since there is explosive growth on online content, one natural offshoot is recommendation, because we cannot read everything, so we need a Google search for the beginning, which is perhaps we thought as a recommendation system. So if you see now in the space of journalism, just the New York Times, it is actually producing like 750 to 800 news stories every day. So people don't know how to, it's now physically impossible to read all this 750 to 800 stories. So users have want some information retrieval, some sort of content recommendation, searching or ranking systems to find important information. So this is the system. Okay, so that is actually beginning to be a huge change in news landscape, and I have 154 slides to actually describe the entire gamut how things. And what we see is that even news media, they are also confused, and they are actually pitched against each other in bitter competition. And lot of news media sites are competing for user attention, which is even becoming rarer and rarer. And the sites are predominantly dependent on, and because even the models are beginning to change, although like New York Times, Washington Post, they charge money for reading, but that is still very nominal, so it's not enough to recover cost. So I will actually talk about three parts. One is, are different recommendation systems deployed on media sites optimal, suboptimal? I will just have a look. So this is a more of an exploratory study where both me and the audience will think aloud, about various questions. Okay, and then we'll see about all this sort of egalitarian crowdsource info recommendation, which is on the face thought to be crowd egalitarian, and are they really egalitarian, or they are mostly biased towards some particular demographic groups? So two of the works which I will present, one is are both done by my PhD, former PhD student, Abhigyan. Saptarshi is also my former PhD student, and Krishna, who is my colleague and friend from Max. So if you see this, the traditional news editors used to manually select important story. This was the plain old things when newspaper used to come. Newspaper still comes, many of us forget, but previously if newspaper didn't come by 7:30, my father used to get mad, and the next day the cycle person would get a thrashing. But that days have gone perhaps. And you see that 180 to 200 news printed in New York Times daily paper, and 15 to 20 stories on the front page. Okay. So now, since we are getting 750 to 800 news stories added every day, you need a recommendation need to be updated 24/7. It's not that in the morning, in the night, there is an editor who comes, picks up the important stories, put it, and it goes to printing in the morning. So see this simple CNN website. Okay, you see this 7 p.m., you see this 8 p.m., it's completely different, it's the same day. 7 p.m. UK triggers Brexit, 8 p.m. Women tried to run over capital offices. Okay. 9 p.m. now it's Plan B. Okay, so it's about Obamacare. Okay, so things are actually changing very, very fast on the web. So with this background, we need automated method for front page news recommendation. We actually need automated method. It cannot be done just by some experience. Yeah, and one of the other work of us is to actually replace experienced people. So that's why also we need automated method. So importantly, so now if you just step back a little and think over that, what are the desired property of a news recommendation? There is a recency concept that you want to recommend stories which are fresh. So you don't want to recommend stories which are stale, but also you want to recommend stories which are relevant. Okay. It's not just recency which matters, it is also relevancy. Okay. So stories recommended, so now relevancy can be two things. I'm just making myself clear. Relevancy can be two things. One is a very personalized relevancy. So that is also something which has come into this journalism domain, that you give personalized news, etc. And that, you know, there are a lot of debates on this, like filter bubble debate, etc., on if you begin to give personalized news. But this is more of a non-personalized setting where we are talking about recommended to users who are not logged in. So, what is relevancy? Just think over that. Relevancy is the impact of a story estimated through its popularity among crowds and number of people who shares and read the stories. Okay. So, if you see an impact of a news story, this is something like this. The news story is born and news story sometimes, it never dies that way, but you can think virtually it dies after sometimes. So, this is the lifetime and this is the relevancy. So, I am keeping a very simple thing that it is the views received in the lifetime. Okay. So now ideally most relevant stories should be recommended soon after their publication. So what you want to do, if you are a very, very good predictor or you understand the story, which story will really become popular, so you will actually recommend it just when it is coming. Okay. Just when it is coming, you will. So, but this is hard to assess a story's impact right after its publication. Impact becomes only after as story ages. So if you see something like this, and the confidence of about its impact actually slowly goes, and if you, and the recency factor actually goes. So as an editor, you always are trying to optimize both recency and impact. So the goal of this work to understand and optimize for the recency relevancy trade-off in a non-personalized news recommendation in online setting. I hope I am fulfilling all the criteria of websites. So this is if you see the existing recommendations, so one is the latest story recommendation. One is highest recent impact story, highest rising impact. These are all things which are there. So, I will just go around for this. Latest story is something like which you see just posted. You see this in the website. So, recommended stories most recently posted maximizes. So, this maximizes recency but doesn't take relevancy into account. Okay. So, now you see also highest recent impact stories, like what is this, that recommended stories having highest popularity over a certain period duration, say delta T, immediately preceding recommendation time. And so something like this, roughly similar, is most emailed in the last 1 hour or most viewed in the last 1 hour. This is something which is like highest recent impact. Then highest rising impact is something like that, some news which is suddenly becoming popular, which has a which recommended story having highest rise in popularity leaving delta T immediately preceding T dash. Okay. And Twitter, it's believed that Twitter trends are actually selected using this highest stories. Okay. So but exactly what we need, if you think carefully, you need highest future impact. It's not just highest impact, highest future impact. It's not that you are standing outside this curve, you are standing somewhere inside this curve, perhaps you are standing somewhere inside this curve and you want to actually understand the highest future impact. So if you think of the future impact would actually decline over time and it's maximum at birth and zero at death. And effectively captures the recency relevancy trade-off. It essentially captures the recency relevancy trade-off. Okay, and now in order to have this highest team, so let me just go back to this and think about some data sets like Yahoo News data set, Cliff News Tool data set, New York Times data set, and I am just putting this, I guess I have made all this algorithms clear: latest, highest lifetime, highest rising impact, highest recent impact, and highest future impact. You see, if we know this highest future impact, we are also doing very good in recency
And also we are doing very good in relevancy. So the average is surely much, much higher than any other algorithm. Whereas if you see recency, the latest performs the best which it should, okay, and it performs the worst, okay. And if you see the two highest rising impact and highest recent impact, highest rising impact is the Twitter trends and highest recent impact is most emailed, etc. You will see that highest recent impact performs worst in recency perform, because a story really needs to roll around sometimes, then the view comes. And highest rising impact is good in recency, but it many times actually falls in relevance. It many times actually fails in relevancy. So see, I just to put one comment here, you will see that most of the time if you follow Twitter trends, the trending topics are those topics which has been promoted by very less number of people. Okay. And suddenly there is maybe a IT cell of some company, some political party which is pushing that. So that highest rising impact can always be gained, and if not that, it is very relevant, and it's always see that it is very slow. Okay. So I have thought about keeping only pictures and less equations and talking. So in Bengali we tell that we talk in chhora ebong chobite, that is like pictures and verses. So I just have one slide of equations. Forgive me for that. Okay. So it's a simple two algorithms. So what you understand is highest future impact really cannot be understood, because how can you understand future? So you need some sort of estimation. Okay. And so here we are presenting two simple type of estimations. One is like ordinary least square estimations, and then gradient tree boosting type of estimation. But there are actually, we have a lot of sophisticated models on this like temporal point process, Hox process, etc., which does this estimation. So let us assume that please give it to us that we have done some deep work on this estimating future impact, and that is how it goes. And this comes with the results, that if you see the results, that latest comes first in recency, while highest future impact, the ordinary least square method, actually comes first in relevancy. And if you see the average ranking, our average ranking is much, much better than any other algorithm. So the takeaway is that existing recommendations achieve suboptimal trade-off between recency and relevancy. And what we understood, we have also talked with people in the journalists, in online journalism. It's not that very clear. The metrics are also not very clear to them how to actually do this. The goal is to achieve a nice recency-relevancy trade-off. Propose a strategy which maximizes a different metric, future impact, not impact, future impact, and optimize future impact, optimizing future impact, which shows that it actually optimizes recency and relevancy. And we have there are implementations on this. How many minutes do I have? That's fine. Okay. So since I have 5 minutes, I will just give you a bit of idea and go through this, that who make trends. Okay. So it's always seen that Twitter trending topics are there, and these are thought to be crowdsourced. And see, there are crowdsourced recommendations on politics, like PC Comey, Clinton, WikiLeaks. These are crowdsourced information on politics. These are crowdsourced information on entertainment, like Dark Tower, Joe Burton. Okay, these are entertainment. Okay. And the question which comes again and again is, who are the people behind this trends? And so the focus of this is to analyze the demographics of crowds promoting the people. So the point is, when this trends come, so the previous work was more so people agnostics. Now we are just delving a little bit into the people part and trying to understand who are the people who actually delve into this. Okay. And so now if you see, That, and why is this important? See, the promoters of trends are like, if you see Wednesday Wisdom. So 52% of women are actually promoting this, while 48% of men are promoting this. Okay. WikiLeaks, if you see, 24% of women are promoting this, while 76% of men are only. And Kome, it's more of white people's trend. It's more about white people's trend than black people's trend. While if you see Clinton, many black people are actually. Okay. And so these are the four research questions. I will not go into this. Then I will again come into some pictures and try to motivate you in the end. So how different are trend promoters from overall Twitter population? So the basic question of fairness would be that if there are 50% of male and 50% of female, the trends should also roughly be similarly things. That is, it shouldn't be that 10% of the 10% of the trends would be promoted by women and 90% by men. And then, are there certainly salient social groups underrepresented? This is very important. Who are underrepresented? And do promoters and adopters of a trend have different demographics? Okay. So, and what are trend promoter demographics tell about trend content? Okay. So, then we have a lot of other things which is done, but I will just take the next 2 minutes into show you some of the pictures of it. So, now, what is promoters and trends? So, trends express niche interest of the promoter group. Okay. And so, it becomes trending topics, but after it becomes trending topics, it seems that many people are using it. So that's why political parties, companies tries to make things trending, because when it becomes trending, it's not that just right-wing or left-wing people are seeing this, everybody is seeing this. So that is the important thing. So now you see black women at work. This is an important hashtag which went out. So if black women want to work, you see that it is mostly promoted by 52% of the blacks, while it is promoted by just 33% of the white. And this is the overall population, Twitter population, where just there is 14% black and 18% Asians and 68% white. If you see the Black Lives Matter, it is 57% blacks, while 14% Asians and 29% whites. So very few whites are actually. So you can immediately understand that the hashtags matters. It's hashtags matters that which group actually is developing this. So with this, we have actually built up a service. You can use this service, that who makes trend. This is already there. And let me just finish it with some of the. So this is a definition used by fans of Golden State Warrior basketball team. Now you see that expectedly most of the trends are actually coming from men. Okay. So now you see, and if you see from Asian black and white, it is mostly a white people trend. Okay, it's mostly a white people. Yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't have the good pictures. So I'll just finish it with this picture. You see Black Lives Matter, there is 57% black, 14% Asian and 29% white. While if you see this same trend which was going on at that time, a parallel trend of Police Lives Matter, which is actually promoted by 74%. So to end it, although there is this crowd wisdom is many times seen in the era of fake news, etc. Crowd wisdom is not really a very good wisdom. There are a lot of regulations and there are a lot of ways of gaming this crowd wisdom. And algorithms are, when we are working in web science, I think we need to develop algorithms which will actually take care of this sort of. So, and this is to end, this is our group, Complex Network Research Group. I'm just hoping Animesh will talk in more detail and use his time to introduce our group.
So, let's end with speaker. Two questions again.
That was a really interesting talk. They all are. I was just there was this story. I mentioned it in my talk yesterday about this refers back to the computational journalism, the open AI not for profit that produced the fake news journalism, said their AI could produce fake news. And my argument yesterday was, well, bad AI can always create fake news. What did you see that story? What did you make of that in the light of your work on computational journalism, or is it?
So I had a different work on like clickbait. I have a different work on clickbait, which I present sometimes. So one of the biggest problem with computational journalism is, I feel, is the economic model, how it is becoming. So the economic model is more about clicking things, getting through advertisement rather than people buying things. Okay. So I guess that has a lot of impact in how things are created, and you are actually thinking of quick bucks and getting things back and finishing things up. So that's how, so AI ultimately would be dependent upon the economy and how economy drives AI. So
well, that's a very good point, because there's potentially conflict of interest if you're trying to advertise something and write a news story. There's a huge conflict of interest there.
Yeah, huge conflict.
Thank you.
So no matter how much Facebook and Google says that they are fighting fake news, they are somehow they are dependent upon that.
So we were having this discussion in the car this morning. Yeah. Thank you.